But anyway, but we'll get started this morning with that. Thank you, everybody, for being here.
Well, with that, we have a special song that we sing here at Mountain Springs for birthdays, and just one for all, Steve, Tony, and Dan. And here it is. If you know it, sing it with me. This is your birthday song. It doesn't last too long. Hey, there we go. See, we expedite those birthdays. Amen. Let's stand together this morning, sing a song, and it's a 4th of July weekend, a lot of people traveling, amen? Okay, let's sing this song. Water you turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like you, none like you. Darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God you are higher than any other. Into the darkness you shine, into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is greater, our God is stronger, God you are higher. Stop us, and if our God is with us, then what could stand against us? If our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Sing it again. What could stand against? Jesus, thank you, Father. Yes, Lord, we thank you this morning that we can celebrate that you are great, you are awesome, you are healer, you are Jehovah Rapha.
Yes.
And Father, we thank you for that. We celebrate that this morning in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. You know what? You can be seated. Let's just sing together. Listen, I hope you know any time that I ask you to be seated and the Spirit of God moves upon you to stand, no one will think differently, okay? So don't feel like you have to sit, but I just want to allow us an opportunity. First of all, yes, we're taking an opportunity to celebrate the freedom that we have in Jesus because of the cross, because of what Christ has already accomplished, that we have the freedom of in our spirit to be able to worship, amen, and to be together on Sunday, and we're thankful for that, but we are mostly thankful for the eternity that has been purchased on our behalf, and the freedom that it is given to us to love others, amen. Amen. Well, praise God. Listen, I chose this song this morning because I thought, you know, the scripture is full, especially the Old Testament. The way that they pass the tenets from generation to generation was oftentimes through songs. And they would teach about their faith. They would teach about their history. They would teach about their ancestry, and it connected the people to their faith and to their belief and who they are, their identity. Now, of course, the gospel being brought to bear on our worship is that we now talk about our identity in Christ and the freedom that God has given us. So when we sing these songs, we're not just singing songs, we're declaring. Yes. Listen to this. We're declaring our faith. Yes. And we're agreeing together in the spirit. We are agreeing on what do we believe. Well, here's what we believe. Amen. It goes like this. Our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. Let's declare, I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one, I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I this song together. Our judge and our defender, suffered and crucified, forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light, forever seated. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one, I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus. One more time. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you this morning that we can celebrate that more. That we declare that you are God our Father, Christ the Son, the Holy Spirit, the three in one, the Trinity. Father, we declare that this morning. We agree. According to your Spirit, Lord, we ask that you administer to our hearts, Lord, as we are in your presence. We sing as unto the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow.
Stand together for these last two stanzas.
Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Lord of good that I have done, nothing but the blood.
Praise God. You can be seated. Children are dismissed, those who are going to be back there. everybody doing today? Thank you, Tony. We worship. We appreciate it. Today our reading is going to be in Acts 14, 8 through 18. While they were at Lystra, Paul and Barnabas came upon a man with crippled feet. He had been that way from birth, so he had never walked. He was sitting and listening as Paul preached. Looking straight at him, Paul realized he had faith to be healed. So Paul called to him in a loud voice, "Stand up." And the man jumped to his feet and started walking. The crowd saw what Paul had done. They shouted in their local dialect, "These men are gods in human form." They decided that Barnabas was the Greek god Zeus and that Paul was Hermes since he was the chief speaker. Now the temple of Zeus was located just outside the town, so the priest of the temple and the crowd brought bulls and wreaths of flowers to the town gates, and they prepared to offer sacrifices to the apostles. But when the apostles, Barnabas and Paul, heard what was happening, they tore their clothing in dismay and ran out among the people, shouting, "Friends, why are you doing this? We are merely human beings, just like you. We have come to bring you the good news that you should turn from these worthless things and turn to the living God, who made heaven and earth, the sea, and everything in them. In the past, he permitted all the nations to go their own ways, but he never left them without evidence of himself and his goodness. For instance, he sends you rain and good crops, gives you food and joyful hearts." But even with these words, Paul and Barnabas could scarcely restrain the people from sacrificing to them. Let's pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I just pray for this family. I pray, Father, for healing, the healing that you have done, you are doing, and you will do, Father. Father, I pray in this family, Father, for people who have burdens, Father, may you lift them. But, Father, we do thank you as your family and your children of the good news that you gave us, the news of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus, Father, who died for our sins so we can have an eternal relationship with you. Father, I pray that you be with Clyde this morning, Father, just as he brings the word today, give him clarity. Father, again, we thank you for Tony with a worship service. I ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
So, am I on?
No.
Am I on now? Okay. So, Thursday, Katie's not here today. She's not feeling well. We took her to the, she was feeling bad. She came to church Wednesday night, was good. And so, she started feeling bad Thursday. I got home on Friday. And, she had gone to her doctor, and her doctor said that she had kidney stones on her right side because her right labrum all the way down her back was hurting, sign of kidney stones. So we go to the ER, we go to the hospital that we normally go to, and we're there from, I don't know, forget what time, but anyway, 12:30, 1:30 in the afternoon until about 4:30 or 5. So we finally, the doctor comes to us, they run all these tests and all that, and they come back and they go, "Well, you know, you have a kidney stone, but it's on your left side, not your right side. And so we really don't know why you're, unless you slipped a disc or something like that, it's why you have that back pain." So, you know, one of the things that I forget, that we're in a spiritual warfare on a day-to-day basis. And so, this morning, I was asking Katie, I said, when did you start hurting? Thursday. That's the same day James asked me to preach. So spiritual warfare is alive in my family. I mean, I fight it all the time. We had another episode right before the ordination where she was sick and just things weren't well at home. So despite what some people think, spiritual warfare is a reality. And the enemy sometimes will attack me through my family. And so I ask that you pray for Katie as we continue to battle through this. I'm glad James and Sky are off doing some recreation. Pray that they'll have safe journeys. Today or tomorrow we actually celebrate our 226th birthday as a nation for freedom. So, you know, 246, so hopefully in 4 years we'll be celebrating 250. But, you know, you always hear this, the truth will set you free. Because we talk about freedoms a lot in the United States, right? The truth will set you free. Well, where does that come from? And you hear people quote that all the time. But where does that come from? Well, I just want to get past this before I get into the message, because freedom, America, we're free, we get to do things and all that. But let's look at what it says about freedom. If you go to John chapter 8 real quick, I'm going to start in verse 28. And it says, Jesus therefore said, when you lift up the Son of Man, he's talking about his crucifixion, then you will know that I am he, and I do nothing on my own initiative, but I speak these things as the Father taught me. Verse 29, and he who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do the things that are pleasing to him. As he spoke these things, many come to believe in him. Break. Then my Bible of the heaven says, the truth shall make you free. Jesus therefore was saying to those Jews who had believed, if or since you abide in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. So that is conditional. That being set free is conditional on what? Knowing the truth. But, okay, well, how do I know that truth? Well, I'm a disciple of Jesus. Well, how do I know I'm a disciple of Jesus? What does he say? Here's the factor. You abide in my word. And what are his words? It's the scripture, Genesis to Revelation. If you know these and abide in him, then you are truly a disciple of mine, and then you will know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. And then let me read on down here to verse 34. Jesus answered them, truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is a slave of sin, and the slave does not remain in the house forever. The Son does remain forever. If therefore the Son, Jesus, shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. So when Jesus sets you free from sin, then you are truly free indeed. Amen? But in order to be his disciple, you need to know the truth. And what's the truth? It's his word. And it's his word that sets you free. And in order to be a disciple of his, you must maintain in his word. And we've been talking about discipleship over the last couple of weeks. So to be free, we need to spend time in God's word and be his disciple by spending time in his word. Okay? So what I want to do now is I want to fast forward to Acts. And what's interesting was yesterday, so I don't know how this is going to go. So yesterday when Katie was in the ER, I'm like, in store of me normally getting, you know, kicking dust and getting mad because I'm having to take her to the ER, I said, well, let's go. I grabbed my Bible. Great time for me to take notes because I know we're going to be there 3 to 4 hours. Allows me to prepare for the message and all that. So I write all these notes down, 2 pages of it. I get home. This morning I'm in prayer and I'm throwing all my notes away. So I don't know how this is going to go this morning. So let's just see what happens. So one of the things that I want to do real quick is, and y'all don't have to turn there, but Acts chapter 13 and verse 1. Now there were at Antioch in the church that was there prophets and teachers, Barnabas and Simon, who was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene and Manian, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch and Saul. So Colton, can you show that up on the screen now? And I like history, okay? And so this I'm glad I don't, I didn't have a message early this morning. It allows me more time, so we'll see what happens. So, and this is kind of fuzzy, but this is ancient Asia, okay? And Antioch is in Syria. And Antioch, in verse chapter 13, verse 1, is a big Gentile church. And this is where Paul and Barnabas was. There was a bunch of believers up here in Antioch, okay? What Paul and Barnabas are fixing to go to is their first missionary journey. And they're going to go visit the church at Antioch has sent out Paul and Barnabas to do missionary work. And what they do is it's a town. But Antioch's this big church, Gentile church, and then Paul and Barnabas go to Salamis and they go to Paphos. And in Paphos, When they're there, one of the pro-council comes to Christ. He's a government official. Then what they do is they sail over here to Perga, go to Attalia, which is the region of Pamphylia, and then they go up to Antioch, Iconium, Derbe, Lystra. Then they go back through, they come back down through Perga, Attalia, and they get back on the boat, come through, and they go back to Antioch. That's his first missionary journey. That encompasses, this is chapters 13 and 14 of what we've been going through. Okay? These are all Gentile areas. Okay? And in fact, the book of Galatians. Okay? The book of Galatians. This area right up in here where Antioch, Lystra, Derbe, Antioch, Iconium, this area up here is known as Galatia. So when Paul writes the letter to the churches at Galatia, he's writing to these churches. You know, now when he writes to the churches at Ephesus, he's writing to this church. And the Corinthian church, he's writing to that church. But this church, these churches here, it's a group of churches that Paul pens the letter to the book of Galatians for. Okay? They are to share it. Now, was it just specifically for them? Was this letter specifically written for the Ephesians? Yes. Did they share it with other churches? Yes, they did. But Paul addressed this letter to the Ephesians strictly to them. But to this group right here, which is what we're going to be going through here in just a second, the book of Galatians would be applied to these churches. Okay? And this was about Paul's first missionary journey from 44 to 46 A.D. is roughly the timeline they say. Some say 48 to 51, but it's kind of around there. And you got to remember, Jesus was crucified around, quote, year 33 or 34. Okay? And the things that James walked us through early on was, remember Paul, when he got saved, he just didn't take off. The book of Acts is written over many, many years. And so Paul is not a new believer when he's in Antioch. He's probably been with the church probably 10, 14 years, somewhere around in there. So he's up in Antioch, and they are fixing to set him aside. They do that in Acts chapter 13, verse 1. And then now they're headed off into the missionary journey. And this is where I want to take up. We left off last week in Acts chapter 14, I think right at verses 14. So today's message is going to be between 16 and 28. But I kind of want to give a little background to where we're at. When you look at Paul and what he's dealt with, you know, he went to this church. In this one here, it's called Antioch Pisidia. So when you read 14, the word Antioch, chapter 14, the first few verses there are in those verses, it's not referring to this Antioch, it's referring to this one. This Antioch is in Syria. This Antioch is in Turkey. And it's a small church. And Paul goes to share the gospel. And in verse 30, I think it's verse 46 of chapter 13, it says this, "And Paul and Barnabas spoke out boldly and said, 'It was necessary that the word of God should be spoken to you first, since you repudiate it and judge yourselves unworthy of eternal life. Behold, we are turning to the Gentiles.'" And that is a huge mark in Paul's ministry. Because before, when Paul and them would show up, they would go to the, you know, all these old cities, ancient cities would have a Jewish synagogue, and that's where Paul and them would go to preach the gospel. Well, here Paul is saying, God is finally saying, I'm, and I'll get into that here in a little bit, where I'm sending you off to the Gentiles. And so Paul says that in verse 46 of 13. He says, "Behold, we are turning to the Gentiles, for thus the Lord has commanded you, I have placed you as a light for the Gentiles, that you should bring salvation to the end of the earth." And when the Gentiles heard this, they began rejoicing and glorifying the word of the Lord, and as many as had been appointed to eternal life believed. So for us, that was a monumental turn in world history, that now the gospel wasn't necessarily focused to the Jews, it was to the Gentiles, which is us. We get to receive the good news of the gospel. Amen? Woo, that's great news, because then the gospel comes to us. And it's interesting because God didn't send them east. He sent them west. So we get to receive the gospel. And we're here because of that moment. Okay. Chapter 14. As they were reading about Paul and Barnabas being called Zeus and Hermes, okay? And I was reading that, and I was like, man, that, you know, that doesn't make a lot of sense. Why would they do that? Well, I dug into that, and this is interesting. This is interesting. So this reaction in Lystra, which was this town right here, this reaction in Lystra was rooted in folklore. According to tradition, Zeus and Hermes visited Lystra incognito, asking for food and lodging. The town turned them away, all but two people. And the two people that didn't turn them away was named Philemon and his wife Bacchus. Now, it's not the Philemon of Scripture, but it was his name, not Philemon, okay? And apparently, Zeus and Hermes took vengeance upon the townspeople in the city and caused the flood to wipe everybody out but those two people. And then they built a temple of Zeus outside of the town. So when this man, and the people know this tradition, so when this man gets healed and jumps up and walking, guess what they think's happening? They remember that Zeus and Hermes once visited this city. They don't want to repeat the process, afraid that they might, you know, bring judgment upon them. And so that's why they got so excited and go, oh my gosh, Zeus and Hermes are visiting us. We don't want to do what our forefathers did. So we're going to offer sacrifices to these two guys. So that's where that comes from. Interesting historical information there. How does that apply? Well, that would lend to believe that that's what the Gentiles believed. Now, let's go, and I'm going to read straight through verses 16 through 28, and then I will go backwards. And in the generations gone by, he permitted all the nations to go their own ways. And yet he did not leave himself without witness, in that he did good and gave you rains from heaven and fruitful seasons, satisfying your hearts with food and gladness. And even saying these things, they with difficulty restrained the crowds from offering sacrifice to them. But Jews came from Antioch, which is in this Antioch, not that one, this Antioch, and Iconium, those two, Iconium. Having won over the multitudes, they stoned Paul and dragged him out of the city, supposing him to be dead. But while the disciples stood around him, he arose and entered the city, and the next day he went away with Barnabas to Derbe. And after they had preached the gospel to the city and had made many disciples, they returned to Lystra and to Iconium and to Antioch, strengthening the souls of the disciples, encouraging them to continue in the faith, and saying, through many tribulations we must enter the kingdom of God. And when they had appointed elders for them in every church, having prayed with fasting, they commended them in the Lord in whom they had believed. And when they had passed through Pisidia and came into Pamphylia, and when they had spoken the word in Perga, they went down to Attalia. And from there they sailed to Antioch, from which they had been commended to the grace of God for the work that they had accomplished. And when they had arrived and gathered the church together, they began to report all things that God had done with them and how he had opened the door of faith to the Gentiles. And they spent a long time with the disciples. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word. Lord, we thank you, Father, that the gospel went west. We thank you, Lord, that we can sit in this church today because of Paul's faithfulness and for the faithfulness of the Antioch church in Syria to send Paul and Barnabas out. We thank you, God, that you called Paul to be the evangelist to the Gentiles. We thank you, Lord, for your word. We pray now, Father, that you would just speak to our hearts and that we would have ears to hear. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. So where I take off on this one is that so now you got these, the city is in uproar because they're wanting to make Paul and Barnabas and offer sacrifices and all that to these two guys because they don't want to repeat what happened in the past. And Paul says, no, wait, stop. You know, we don't want to do that. And what he does is he appeals to their minds about the creator of the universe. And the big difference between how he addresses the Gentiles and the Jews, he would go back and do what? He would take the Old Testament and he would show them how Christ was in the Old Testament. But with the Gentiles, he couldn't appeal to that because they had no knowledge of that. 1 Corinthians, it says that a natural man cannot understand the things of God because they are foolishness to him. Okay, the cross is foolish. So what Paul does, he says, hey, look, the God of creation has given you signs that there is a God. He's given you rain, he's given you wind, he's given you all these elements. Not only that, he's given you a conscience. And if you go to Romans, and I'm not going to read all of it, but Romans chapter 1, verses 18 and 32, it talks about how God has put within every man that there is a creator, and they reject that, and they start worshiping the creation over the creator. And that's what the Gentiles were doing. Vain idols. And so they were wanting to make these supernatural guys, and Paul and them ripped their clothes, which for the Jewish tradition means blaspheming. Okay? But what happens is here comes trouble. So the church, the small church from Antioch and Iconium, the two Jewish groups, two people come from there, the Jews come from there, and they persuade the Gentiles that these men are false teachers. And so what does the scripture say? It says they stone him and drag him out of the city. Now let's go to Acts chapter 9. I'll read a couple things here. This is the conversion of Saul. Verse 3. And it came about that as he journeyed, he was approaching Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. And he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Now, was Paul persecuting Jesus? What was he doing? At this point, he had gotten letters from the Jewish leaders to go to Damascus to persecute the believers, to persecute the church. Well, he was persecuting the church, but Jesus says, why are you persecuting me? Because when you persecute the church, you are persecuting Jesus. When you persecute a believer, you are persecuting the church, which then therefore you're persecuting Jesus. So Paul has this happen to him, and he said, who art thou, Lord? And Jesus said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But arise and enter the city, and it shall be told you what you must do. Now move over to verse 15. And this is after Jesus had told Ananias to go and take and meet with Paul and all that. And here's what it says about Paul. This is what Jesus says about Paul. But the Lord said to him, go, for he is a chosen instrument of mine to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the sons of Israel. For I will show him how much he must suffer for my name's sake. So that was what Jesus was telling Ananias that he was supposed to do, that Paul was supposed to do, that he was going to be a witness to the Gentiles first, then the kings, but he was also going to see, hey, this is how much he was going to have to suffer. Let's go to Acts chapter 7. Verse 55. This is Stephen being stoned. But being full of the Holy Spirit, he gazed intently into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And he said, behold, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. But they cried out with a loud voice and covered their ears, and they rushed upon him with one impulse. And when they had driven him out of the city, they began stoning him, and the witnesses laid aside their robes at the feet of a young man named who? Saul. So now let's fast forward years, and now Paul is in Lystra, and he's preaching a message, and the Jews come from Iconium and Antioch, and they drag him out, and what do they do to him? They stone him. What do you think Paul was thinking of and thinking about when he was being hit? Do you think he thought of Stephen and he witnessed Stephen's murder? Without a doubt. Without a doubt. Now, how does that apply to y'all? Clyde, what are you trying to say? Well, I can't tell you how many times as a non-believer I used to persecute Christians, make fun of them, laugh at them, joke about them, and all that other stuff. And in turn, that's happened to me. Is that something that, you know, that God puts on me? No, it's not that. But I represent Christ now, and so when I do that, I bring those things upon me because of the name of Jesus. So they stone this guy, and there is no doubt in my mind that Paul's going, oh boy, rewind. Stephen, he was there, and I think that's why Paul says he's the chief of sinners, because he witnessed and was a participant in a murder of one of his brothers and sisters that became his brothers and sisters years later. And so this is Paul getting hit upside. I was going to bring a rock. I forgot it. But, you know, I mean, a good-sized rock. Imagine getting hit in the head with one of those. When I was a kid, we used to have rock fights. I got in the head one time, man. I got real, real woozy. But I can't imagine being hit so many times that when they drug him out of the city, they thought he was dead. But, you know, I think it was last week when James read in Romans 8 that neither death nor life can separate us, and he went on and listed a bunch of things that could separate us from that love. And Paul even writes, what can man do to me? I mean, Paul knew and understood that his faith was complete in Christ and that nothing that man could do to him could separate him from that love. Now, think about that, church. All this stuff that we're dealing with. The other day I'm driving down the road and I'm talking to a friend on the phone, and he's a born-again believer, and I'm just thinking, man, when you think about all the mess that's going on in this world, all the stuff, I have hope. If nothing else, I have hope that when all this thing gets bad, I'm out of here. Okay? I have that hope. But can you imagine a lost person? They have no hope. And I try to think back to when I was lost and I didn't have hope. But I can't even perceive that now. And in a way, I'm glad, but in a way, I'm not glad, because I want to relate, and I can relate, but I'm just think about all the stuff that's going on in the earth right now and what's happening and what the plan is. The other day, I was watching news, and it showed a White House spokesman said, and this is a quote, "The liberal world order wants high gas prices." Now, I don't care about the gas prices, but the comment, "the liberal world order," one world government, okay? That's fine. You can have it. I know where my faith is. And that's where Paul, I mean, they bust him in the head with stones and rocks, and he gets up. They drag him out. He gets up, and it says, the Bible says, he goes back into the same city that they drug him out of. Now, as Christians, how many of us want to, you know, if I'm going back in there, I'm going to take a rock, I'm going to take a gun, I'm going to destroy this place, right? Would we not do that? Yeah, we would do that. We would seek vengeance. Not Paul. And it says that the other disciples, I don't know why the other ones didn't get hit in the head with a rock, but the other disciples, it says they stood around and watched him, and Paul gets himself up off the ground, and he's you know, cut, bruised, and bladed and all that, gets up and walks right back into the city. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I'll tell you the story. When I was in Uganda one time, there was this guy. He was, quote, the apostle in the area. And we were having a soccer tournament, and this guy came in and stirred up all kinds of mischief, all kinds of mischief. And I was doing a soccer clinic in this field, and the field was walled by a brick wall, which is about 8 feet tall. Well, we ended up, this soccer team came in and wasn't playing well and hurting people, so we kicked them out. Well, they went around the wall, and now remember, this pastor guy was stirring up trouble. Well, they picked up rocks and started throwing them at everybody. There was only one guy that got hit in the head, and it was that pastor that was stirring up trouble. And here's what he came back and said. He said that, he goes, "Man, maybe God's trying to tell me something." And we were like, "Yeah, maybe he is." You know, but it's just interesting that Paul gets up and walks back into town. And then look what it says then from moving on. And that's in verse 18. It says, he dragged him out of the city, supposing to him be dead. They thought he was dead, but he wasn't. But while the disciples stood around him, he arose and entered the city. And the next day he went away with Barnabas to Derbe, another town. So Paul gets stoned, doesn't go to the hospital, gets up, takes Barnabas. And where do they go? They continue on their missionary journey to the next town, Derbe. Why? To share the gospel. Paul had a passionate desire to share the gospel. That was why he knew he was here, is to share the good news of the gospel. Why? Because people were lost, but also because he knows the power of God and the Holy Spirit, how he can redeem lives. And that's what drove Paul, was to share the good news of the gospel. He didn't lay about. He didn't lay in the bed. He didn't say, "Oh, I think I'm a couple days off." Boom. He went right to Derbe to present the gospel in a city that he wasn't known, and he went right back preaching the gospel. faithfulness, the faithfulness of God. Verse 21. And after they, him and Barnabas, had preached the gospel to the city and had made many disciples, look at what they do. They returned to Lystra and to Iconium and to Antioch. Okay, so Lystra, where he got stoned, he went back to Antioch and Iconium, where the Jews came to Lystra to stir up trouble. He went back. Why did he go back? To strengthen the new believers in Christ. To give them hope. Sometimes as a church, we need to be strengthened. Go to Colossians. No, go to Ephesians 1:19. 1:18. And when you read some of Paul's messages, these are some of the things that he says. There's prayers in here. And here's what he says. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened, so that you may know what is in the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the surpassing greatness of his power toward us who believe. These are in accordance with the working of the strength of his might, which he brought about in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things in subjected under his feet, and he gave him his head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. So Paul's writing this letter to the Ephesians to give them encouragement about, hey, in Christ, we have been seated in Christ, and these are in the heavenly places, and these are the things that he does for us. And so when we lose hope, and remember when I was talking about God's Word and spending time in God's Word and abiding in God's Word, you can go to God's Word when you're not feeling, and you can get hope from God's Word to carry on, to be encouraged, to continue on in strength. And that's what Paul was doing. Paul, you know, went to Antioch, to Iconium, to Lystra, to Derbe, and then he went back because he wanted to speak to the brethren. Go to Colossians chapter 2. Now, this is a prayer that I have been praying for this church for many, many, many years. Go to verse 9, middle of that, all the way through 12. And this is what I pray for this church and many, many, many other churches that I have visited and have written down. Colossians 1, 9 through 12. That you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you may walk in a manner worthy of the Lord to please him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all power according to his glorious might for the attaining of all steadfast and patience, joyously giving thanks to the Father, to you, Lord, who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. Now, there is a lot in that, and I'm not even going to attempt to unpack all that stuff. But I pray that you would have the knowledge of God's will, that you as an individual believer would understand and pray also that you would receive God's will for your life and that you would operate within that will and that you would receive, what else does it say? That you would receive, that you would be filled with all spiritual wisdom and understanding, not man's understanding, but God's understanding, that you may walk in a manner worthy of the Lord to please him in all respects, and that you bear fruit in every good work. So the things that you do for God, that you bear fruit in those. And that's what I pray for this church. That's what I pray for the believers in this church, is that you would bear fruit in every good work, that you would be about doing the good works that God has called you to do. And I don't know what those are for you individually, but I pray that God would do that in your life. And if you don't know what those are, you need to be praying for that. Praying according to God's will in your life to find out what those are. That's what he's gifted you with. Verse 11, strengthened with all power. Now get that. all power. Where does that power come from? That all power? Who has all power? Satan has some power. But who has all power? God has all power. Now, I can't even imagine what that is. And, I talk to about people and they say the Big Bang, I said, yeah, I believe in that. God spoken and bang, there it was. That is all power, right? Right? Yeah. Or when this one really blows my mind. Jesus knew he was going to raise himself up from the dead. I mean, you look at dead things, man, they're dead. Not when it comes to Jesus, right? He gets up on the third day. Even death didn't have power over him. So Satan has limited power, but my God, whom I serve, has all power. And if he has all power and I'm in Christ, what does that mean? Does it mean I have all power? No, but it means Christ in me, through me, has all power. Amen. Right? And so when Paul says, I believe that there's nothing that can separate us from the love of God, what can man do to me? Amen. When Satan wanted to harass Job, did he have the freedom to go harass Job? Uh-uh. He had to go ask God first. God gave him permission to do that. Why? To show, I believe, the enemy that even with that a man filled with the power of God will walk according to God's word. Man or woman. And that's what the enemy likes to do. But when we have a crisis in our life, understand that crisis has to get permission first from God to become a crisis in our life. Now, I've got my sister and they're going through some medical situations, and she's very argumentative, and I don't argue with them anymore. But one of the things that she says is this. She says that God, you know, Clyde, God never puts on us more than we can handle. How many of y'all believe that? I don't believe that. I don't believe that at all. God always puts more on you than you can handle. You know why? So you can trust Him in that crisis. If you can get through the crisis alone, you don't need God, right? Uh-uh. All these things that have been going on with Katie and all that, I mean, these are crises that he gets, but he knows that we can get through them. And I've said before, most of these crises is when we get through them, I learn more about God as I go through the sufferings and these crises than I ever would not. And I also learn more about myself and a little bit about my wife, although she's going through them. But I know in my life I learn a ton about myself. Usually it's not good, but when I get through it, it's usually good because then God reveals, Clyde, this is what I want you to learn. Not so much about you, but about me through that crisis. And so Paul takes this opportunity. I mean, you know, he could have got stoned. And he could have said, man, Barnabas, I've had enough of this mess. We're going back to Antioch, the big Antioch. He said, uh-uh, we're not done. We're going to continue on. So they go to Derbe, and they're strengthening the churches. And here's what it says. Go back to Acts, and it goes back to verse 21 or 22, and it says strengthening. So he does a few things here. And after they had preached the gospel to the city and had made many disciples, they returned to Lystra and to Iconium and to Antioch. They did a couple things. One, they strengthened the souls of the disciples. They strengthened them. They encouraged them to continue in the faith, saying that, hey, look, through many tribulations we must enter the kingdom of God. I've known many people that said, oh, I became born again, but, because of this, I'm no longer and I walk away. Well, honestly, what that tells me from a biblical perspective is they were never born again in the first place. And I'll be more than happy to sit down with somebody and talk to them about that versus just a real quick conversation. But the reality of it is, I mean, those that are truly born again are going to work through whatever crisis you have because, remember, I went back, read John. If I abide in God's word, right? If I abide in God's word, what is God's word? Genesis to Revelations. What does Peter say in chapter 2, I believe? That we are going to go through, you know, sufferings and all that. James in chapter 1, verse 2 and 3 says, hey, you know, just remember that when you're going to endure these things, there's other brothers and sisters, that perseverance will come about and patience and all that. So we're going to go through trials and tribulations. It's what the scripture says. But it's what we do with those things that we come out on the bright side. Right? Right? So let's look at verse 23 and 14:23. And when they had appointed elders, so they just didn't say, hey, here's the church, boom, we're out of here. Paul and Barnabas appointed elders. Why? To keep the church discipled, to keep the church growing. Okay? They appointed elders for them in every church, having prayed with fasting. Dave and I had a conversation about fasting the other day. They commended them to the Lord in whom they had believed. So Paul and Barnabas prayed over these elders and all that, commended them to the Lord. And remember, those churches that they were in, Colton, can you show that up again, please, sir? That all those churches in this area now had elders. So Antioch, Iconium, Derbe, and Lystra all had elders now. They had churches. So he commended them, and he said, here you go. But Paul shared the gospel. They created churches. He just didn't leave them, and he came back through to build them up, to strengthen them. Okay? Verse 24. And they passed through Pisidia and came to Pamphylia. And Pamphylia is this area right down through here, which is another region within Galatia. It says they passed through Pisidia, and I know I'm not pronouncing that right, but that was a mountainous region that they kind of stayed away from. And this area right in here was kind of marshy, so they didn't stay there a long time. It says, and when they had spoken the word in Perga, they went down to Attilia. So again, they were always doing what? Sharing the good news of the gospel, that Jesus saves, to these Gentiles that believed in these false gods, that these man-made gods, that these idols that have no, they have eyes but they don't see and ears that don't hear. We have a lot of that going on in our lives. We just call them different things. We call them sports or cars or job or money. And those things are good. But when they become a god, quote, little g, it becomes a bad thing. And it depends on the individual and how they can handle it. But they got to Attilia, verse 26, and from there they sailed to Antioch. So they're going back to Antioch, their home church, to report. And from there they sailed to Antioch, from which they had been commended to the grace of God for the work that they had accomplished. Okay. Let's go to 1 Peter 2. I love this scripture here. Ooh, this is good. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, 10. Okay? So here we go. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. That's good. That is so good. Because remember, and I'll go on here, and you'll see what I'm talking about. That you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Why? For you were once not a people, but now you are the people of God. You had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Woo, that's good. We were a people separated from God, but the good news of the gospel brings us in so now that we can have fellowship with God. We were once not a people of God, but now we are part of the people of God. Man, we're part of God's family, right? But why are we, what's part of being part of that family? So what Paul and Barnabas did, they came back, and I would have loved to heard about Barnabas' testimony about Paul. Yeah, we're standing there one day, and Paul gets stoned to death. They thought he was dead, but he wasn't dead. They stoned him. And you know what this brother did? He got up and walked right back into the city. Yeah, Tony, right? And the church in Antioch was probably, one of those guys was probably, yeah, that's probably true. You stoned Stephen, and so God got you back, didn't he? But just the testimony of these guys. Now, I say all that, and I give a lot of examples and stuff of when I go to Africa, okay? And I do that because there's brothers and sisters over here in Africa, and I give them testimonies of what's going on in the life of my church. And then I bring those testimonies back that I experienced over here to this church and to other the churches I used to attend to also strengthen in them, okay? Now, I'm going to tell you right now, September 8th, around there, I'm leaving, and I'm going for 2 weeks, and I'm going to go to Zimbabwe, South Africa, Zambia, and Lesotho, okay? And I'm going to be gone for 2 weeks, and I'm going to go, and I'm going to testify to our church, and then I'm also going to come back, and I'm going to testify the things that God has done in the midst of that. And what that does is it strengthens the church. Look at what happened here. Go back to Acts 14. 26, and from there they sailed to Antioch, from which they had been commended to the grace of God for the work that they had accomplished. So they went back to the home church that sent them out. And when they had arrived and gathered the church together, they began to report all things that God had done with them and how he had opened the door of faith to the Gentiles. And they spent a long time there with the disciples. And what that says, when I looked it up, it says that they spent about a year at Antioch back encouraging the disciples and all that. But when you get... And I read Peter, when you read that and you just think that we were lost, alienated, separated from God, and now because of what Christ has done, we are part of God's family. Because the Jews rejected their call. They didn't do what God asked them to do, was to go share the good news of who God was to the Gentile nations. They didn't do that. And then Christ came, died on that cross, rose again to give us life, that we would no longer be separated from God, but that we would be a family of God. Amen. A family of God. And Dave and I were talking the other day. So many times people, and I've said this again, I keep saying this again, Jesus tore that veil into the Holy of Holies. I have direct access to the Holy of Holies. But what we want to do sometimes, or most times, as people of God, we want to stay out in the court of the Gentiles. And we don't want to get into that Holy of Holies, because that Holy of Holies is what it'll cost us. Don't know what it'll be for individuals. But y'all in here, everyone in here has been gifted with a gift that God has gifted you with through the power of the Holy Spirit. I know what mine is, gift of evangelism. And, you know, it was funny, and I'll tell you this, it's hilarious, and Tony can testify to this. A couple months ago, Tony and I were talking. Tony goes, Clyde, have you ever thought being a pastor? What'd I say, Tony? You remember? Yeah. I'm not a pastor. I don't know. I think you are. Nah, I'm not. What happened a couple months later? But I've always said, with my walk with Christ, it's whatever God wants to do in my life, he has freedom to do. If that means be a pastor, that's what I'll be. I still shake my head. It's amazing what God has done and what he continues to do. You know, and so the encouragement for y'all here, and this is what this is why I kind of led with John, is because we throw that scripture out there, you know, the truth will set you free, you know, okay, yeah, but what's the context? And I gave the context of it, is that, you know, if you abide in God's word, there's so much richness in God's word. Man, there's so much hope. There's so much strength and so much encouragement. And, you know, Paul and them, when they went back to encourage the churches, it was by verbal, which is great. But we've got his spoken word written down for us. Go to Colossians chapter 2. And I'll tell you, if I ever need any kind of encouragement, and I'm just really having a bad, just really bad day, let me read this to you. Okay, 13 through 17, for he, Jesus, delivered us from the dominion of darkness, woo-hoo, and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. And he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created by him and for him, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. That's who this Jesus is. And he does all that, he's a great creator of the universe, and yet he saved me. And positionally, I am in Christ. And I am seated with Christ at the right hand of the Father. In Christ. So when Paul's praying these, writing these prayers out about the churches and all that, he's writing about me. That he's wanting to encourage me as I read the scriptures. That I would be strengthened with God's will. And that I would have all spiritual knowledge and understanding. But when you grasp what Christ is and what he's done for you, ooh, my goodness. I can see why Paul got up and goes, I'm going right back in there and preach the gospel. I've never been threatened like that. I've never had a rock thrown at me because of the gospel, or anything like that. That may or may not come, but if it does, it does. You know, I've had somebody slam a door in my face, and I just got off his porch, took my shoes off, and snapped them and got all the dust off because that person's house is not worthy of the gospel message that I gave. That's what Scripture teaches me to do. I don't do that to everybody, but I do it to some. But the gospel and what Paul did and the disciple makers, and that's what he did. He just didn't. Discipleship is so important. It's not like he just went to the churches and didn't go back. What would those churches and what would the church look like today if we didn't have the letters? What would they look like? Be scary. I don't even know if we'd have a church. But there's encouragement and hope in the scriptures. There's encouragement and hope in the church. When we hear testimonies of people and the things that have overcome and things that people have come from and being born again, and it's just a witness and power of God. And that's what Paul was doing. And they have a sending out church in Antioch. And you can understand this, that big church in Antioch, Syria, they relished and were very part of the ministry. And the one thing that the church in Antioch did, the big church in Antioch, in Acts chapter 11, that's where they're first called Christians, okay? And it was kind of a make fun of word. But the other thing they did is that they took up a huge offering for the relief of the brethren in Jerusalem during a huge famine, Acts chapter 11. And that's what the church does. The church is there to support each other locally and to support each other universally. I'll leave you on this one note. You know, the church gave Pastor Joseph, we sent him some money and all that, and what he did with it was, I thought it was weird, but he did it. He went and bought a solar-paneled video projector so he could go up into the mountains of Uganda, into the village, and show the Jesus film. That's what this church participated in. And whether you not even know those people that get saved over in Uganda, you're a part of that. You're a part of that sending out Antioch church. And I'm waiting for the pictures to come back when he so I can show them and we can put them up here. But that's what this church does. And did. And will continue to do, hopefully. We'll see. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you for your message. God, we thank you for, Lord, I no notes. I had a little, but, Lord, I just thank you. But, Lord, we need to be encouraged. We need to be blessed. We throw that out there too many times, if the truth will set us free. But where does that come from, Lord? The context in which that is that if we abide in your word, then we are truly your disciples. And then we will know the truth. Your truth is the Word of God from Genesis to Revelation. And Lord, that we know that when Jesus has set us free from sin, oh, we are free, Lord. We are free. And we thank you so much for that, Father. Lord, I pray that you'd speak to every heart and mind here today. We give you honor and glory for who you are. And we look with great anticipation of what you're going to do with these group of believers here. Lord, we thank you that the Galvins are in church today. We thank you for that. Pray for James and Skies are out and enjoying time away. Lord, I continue to pray for my wife, Katie. Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We give you honor and glory for who you are, Father. Man, we thank you that we are a chosen nation, a royal priesthood, a people for your own possession, Lord. Because of Christ, we can say that we are the people and children of God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's stand together. Amen. I've been encouraged this morning. You? Amen. Let's sing together. Let's testify of who God is. Amen.
And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against?
Sing it again. What could stand against? What could stand against? Thank you, Lord.
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome.
This morning that we can celebrate that you are for us and not against us, Lord, that you have gifted us, Lord, individually to be a representation of who you are, the body of Christ, the church. Lord, if there be that one person here that from the moment they came in today, they feel like they're on the outside of something looking in because they don't remember a time that they ever ask you to become Lord and Savior of their life. Lord, give them the boldness and the courage to be able to take someone by the hand and to be able to say, I want to pray that prayer. I want to become a part of the body of Christ. To connect, Lord, with my history, with my ancestry through Jesus, Lord. We thank you this morning for that. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen, amen.